Thank you, Stephen, for the introduction. Thank you, Jan and Andrea, for the invitation here. This is my first time in Aalst, very nice town. Well, this is a abrupt change. We came from xenon to something that is pretty not expensive, so CO2. How can you use these guys to improve our way to conduct anesthesia? So these are my disclosures here. Well, the first one of them, so I had some patents on the use of the partial CO2 rebrief maneuver for measuring the pulmonary capillary blood flow, but this is an old patent, and I have some conflict of interest with the company Dräger. So we heard a lot about the use of different gases, so I think more or less there is no doubt that we will be able to KO our patients in some way. But so what we have normally is that the anesthesiologist is pretty busy with other things. We're trying to take some of these tasks from the anesthesiologist, mainly for the time where the seconds of terror occur. And what we have is more or less, well, this is old fashioned now, but as you can see here, different monitors, different devices that we are trying to automatize. And one of them, which is the my talk today, is the breathing system. So how can we target this? How can you waive some of the tasks of the anesthesiologists? Well, just looking back at the physiology, we know that CO2 is produced so in the periphery from the metabolism of glucose. And this is transported to the lungs through perfusion. So you have some information regarding this perfusion, regarding the hemodynamics. And of course, you need to eliminate this gas so you get some information on the ventilation. And they try to use this, to gather some information on how is the perfusion maybe also and how is the ventilation. So normally what we have is the end-tidal values of the CO2 to do this. They are pretty easy. We know that the end-tidal CO2 correlates well with cardiac output, at least in the hypodynamic states. In the normal dynamic states, it correlates very well with the elimination with the minute volume and CO2 elimination. We know that the minute ventilation can be tailored to match the metabolism of the CO2 in the periphery. And more or less what you have is an exchange of one molecule of CO2 against one molecule of oxygen. So the information that we get normally is from the capnogram. And the capnogram is here shown. So you have the CO2 over time, which is, do you have a pointer? Yes. So you have the CO2 over times here. And what you can see is in the phase 3, so you are almost achieving this level here, which is comparable to the arterial or to the alveolar level of CO2. And this is the value that we get. So, but there is much more information in the CO2 elimination, not over time, but over the volume that you have, over, for instance, the tidal volume, which is the volumetric capnogram, which is placed here. So if you get some more information, let's say, if you have the arterial PCO2 as well, then you can plot different areas here in this curve of the volumetric capnogram. For instance, you have the X area, which is this CO2 elimination by itself. You have information here on the anatomic dead space, and you have also information, this is the Y area here on the alveolar dead space. So these are information that you have more or less free of cost, so different from other things. And what is the good news about this issue here is, so you are with the end-tidal CO2, we are very close in most patients from the PaCO2. Let's see what happens during anesthesia and if this holds true when we induce the anesthesia in our patients. What you have here are two models of the respiratory effects of anesthesia on the respiratory system. Whether you use this model that you have a shift of the diaphragm towards the cranial areas, or if you have only this part here moving, what we get always is decreasing the FRC, so you have some compromise of the respiratory mechanics, you have some more airway closure, surfactant inactivation, and mainly the formation of telectasis. And this is represented here. So this is a horse in the CT facility of Professor Henrik Stjerne in Uppsala, Sweden. So before the induction of anesthesia, you have more or less no atelectasis, as you can see here. But after the induction of atelectasis, anesthesia, what you get is what is represented here. So in this animal here, what you get is a huge area and volume of atelectasis. And this can have some influence, of course, on the gas exchange. But this is mainly, this influence is mainly on oxygen, as you see. So this is from a human. What you see here, also some formation of atelectasis. You have here the distribution of the ventilation, and you have on the dots of the perfusion. You can see here that what we normally get when we induce anesthesia is this atelectasis here leading to the formation of areas of shunt, of true shunt. And of course, there's some formation of alveolar dead space. And this is important for us because this has some effects on the CO2 and the utility of the CO2. So measured that way with the midget technique, what you can see here is from the spontaneous breathing down to the induction of anesthesia and intubation of the patient. So you had here, for instance, alveolar dead space of 22. Now it's 27, not that a problem. But what do you see here? You had almost, well, you had nothing of shunt here, and now you have 12% of shunt. So if you take into account this model here, well, let's say a two-compartmental model, first of the gas exchange with some shunt and with some dead space. So what we know is from the isoshunt curves is that the formation of shunt, the formation of atelectasis, has a huge influence on the PO2. And this is represented here. So you see what happens with the isoshunt curves with 0 up to 30% of shunt. But what we know is that effects on the PCO2, they are less relevant. CO2 is very diffusible and escapes as well this system here. So I would say most of the patients that we have, they will not have such high shunt. And this is the reason why we can really say that the association, the correlation between the end-tidal CO2 and the alveolar CO2 is very good. Of course, there are some exceptions. You see here a patient that had a very high increase of the of these areas here of low ventilation, areas that are still perfused. So you have here some formation of alveolar dead space. But I'd say this is not the rule. This is the exception. Again, to the model here, even if you have some formation of alveolar dead space, so what you get always is that you have a constant relationship between your alveolar ventilation and the alveolar PCO2 and the CO2 elimination. So if you induce anesthesia, so you decrease the CO2 elimination over time, but it's still, so you are moving over this curve here. So if you know more or less the difference, the gradient that you have between end-tidal CO2 and PCO2, so we can say it is almost constant over time. So the question that we pose at this time here, so with the CO2, you can gather what is the CO2 elimination, you can gather what is the alveolar CO2, even the alveolar CO2. And the main question is how to combine this with other information that we get also from the CO2. Can CO2 be used for the monitoring of hemodynamic variables as well? Well, this is an old study from our group, which is represented here at the time that we worked with the so-called partial CO2 rebriefing. So you see here CO2 elimination over time, breath by breath. And you see here the end-tidal CO2, breath by breath. We have three conditions. One is the hyperdynamic, the other is the normal dynamic, and the hypodynamic. And we can calculate for each of them according to the conservation of the mass principle using this thick equation here. You can calculate the pulmonary capillary blood flow in this situation here where you have normal CO2 elimination. Then you increase that space, let's say, with a valve, and you decrease the CO2 elimination, we increase the end-tidal CO2. You can also calculate here the pulmonary capillary blood flow. The problem is that normally what we don't have in this equation here is the mixed venous CO2. But if we combine both of those equations here, assuming that this mixed venous CO2 does not change over time, which is a reasonable assumption, so then you can calculate the pulmonary blood flow from changes in CO2 elimination and changes in the content, the capillary content of the CO2. And you can calculate this difference in here only from end-tidal CO2 values. That is, so not only you have information about ventilation, CO2 elimination, but you can even have information about the perfusion, and you can possibly match those informations to try to conduct your ventilation strategy. So this is part of the results that we obtained at that time. We had two situations, so a very non-invasive algorithm, no blood samples, and this is another algorithm with some samples of arterial blood trying to correct for these differences between arterial and end-tidal CO2, small difference. And what you can see here is almost a total agreement between the invasive measured capillary blood flow. In this situation here, if we use the semi-invasive algorithm, so you still have, of course, this kind of agreement. When you move to a high VQ, and high VQ means here a hyperdynamic state, still, so in the lower values of cardiac output, still you have some agreement here. If you use some values coming from arterial blood samples, you have an agreement between the non-invasively measured and invasively measured cardiac output. Of course, you are moving to a high shunt or a very high over that space, then you lose this kind of agreement. So there are many other possibilities to try to join this information, and one of them is represented in this model here. We know that when we are working during anesthesia, we work a lot with PEEP. If we increase the PEEP, we are increasing oxygenation, we are diminishing the intrapulmonary shunt. So we are diminishing this mismatching that you have between ventilation and perfusion normally. But also you reduce the venous return to the heart, and you have a decrease in the cardiac output. So ideally, what we get is some kind of relationship between the pulmonary blood flow with the PEEP. In that way, it's more or less a parabolic relationship with a maximum. So there is a level of PEEP that maximizes the pulmonary blood flow. So this could be useful to titrate also the mechanical ventilation in terms of the settings of PEEP. But the question is, should we, should we combine it really with other variables? Well, some engineers from the group that I work at in Brazil, they tried to do this. They're combining the end-tidal CO2 with measurements of the elastance of the respiratory system, so using some objective functions. So they had this PI controller that you are seeing here, and they tried not only to titrate the respiratory rate, but also the PEEP levels in an attempt to optimize the mechanical properties of the respiratory system. And this was what they saw with the in some animals, some pigs ventilated. The pigs had no lung injury. So you see that depending on the level of PEEP that you have different values of elastance. So the lungs can be stiffer, they can be softer. So it's maybe a good idea also to combine the CO2 with this kind of measurement here. And regarding the CO2, well, based on the controller that they had, it was possible to achieve some stability in the control of the PaCO2 levels. As you can see here, this is in seconds, so in less than 2 minutes. So a pretty easy task and possibly an interesting one. But if you ask me what we anesthesiologists, we are really looking for, so we are not looking that much at mechanical properties of the respiratory system and optimization of the PEEP according to a functional parameter. So we are interested in better outcome. One of them is represented here, the so-called postoperative pulmonary complications. So we know that postoperative pulmonary complications, they can contribute importantly to the total risk of surgery. We know that the PPCs, they influence the length of stay in the hospital and even the mortality. In the US, the costs that were estimated due to these PPCs are about $3.4 billion And in Europe, we know that 8% of patients, according to one study that we performed, they develop PPCs. And well, talking about major surgery, for instance, open abdominal surgery, we know that the risk of developing a PPC is higher than 40%. So how can mechanical ventilation modulate these numbers here? This is a meta-analysis that is submitted at this moment with more than 3,000 patients, as you can see here, made by a huge group involved with the ESA. Well, what this guy says, could see was that the tide of volume, as you can see here, had a major influence for the hazard ratio in terms of the development of PPCs. So the lower the tide of volume, the lower the risk of developing PPC. So in terms of secondary outcome measures, as let's say the length of hospital stay, also the lower the tidal volume, the lower the risk of developing such complications. And what we did not expect is even hospital mortality was influenced by the tidal volume. So, but there was no influence of PEEP, there was no influence of the respiratory rate. In fact, so if you try to plot the tidal volume against the probability of developing, let's say, a severe respiratory insufficiency, you see the lower the tidal volume, the lower the chance to develop this. Well, do you really need the control of all of these parameters? Of course, yes. But where should we focus on? Is it the tidal volume, RR, respiratory rate, or the PEEP control? So we performed this study here, which was published recently. This is a major, let's say, network that has gained this data that I will present here. Well, it was based on the assumption that the use of PEEP could be protective against these PPCs during open abdominal surgery. So PPCs were defined as one of this list here. So you have a less severe complication to a very severe complication as ARDS, but they count in the same way for this project here. So the way that we ventilate those patients is represented here, either with a low PEEP or with a high PEEP. The low PEEP group had 2 or less, the high PEEP 12. And we applied some recruitment maneuvers in this group as well. The tidal volumes were 8 ml per kilogram, and the RR was adjusted to achieve an end-tidal CO2 between 35 and 45 millimeters of mercury. So the recruitment maneuver that we used was more or less a same automatized one. So we had a fixed level of PEEP, and we increased the tidal volume stepwise, and then we decreased again. The tidal volume was increased to achieve plateau pressure between 30 and 35, trying to open those areas of the lungs that were atelectatic. Well, what we saw was, really, in terms of the mechanical properties of the respiratory system, and what you see, you're seeing here is the dynamic compliance of the respiratory system. Well, there was a huge effect, much higher if we use the higher PEEP compared to the lower PEEP. And well, in terms of other, let's say, complications in the intraoperative period, so the use of the higher PEEP was associated with more hypotension, need for vasoactive drugs, and some fluids. In terms of the primary endpoint, and this is very important here, what we saw was this, what is represented here, no effect at all. So these issues of trying to, let's say, target our efforts on some functional parameters may be misleading, as we could show here with this study. So if you see here, one of the major PPCs that we expected to avoid with levels of PEEP that were higher was hypoxemia. You see here, no difference. Pleural effusion has nothing to do with our PEEP, I would say. Well, what I can tell you, I think that it's pretty easy a task for here the engineers among us to the companies. So for the most procedures, we believe at this time that the control of the respiratory rate upon the end-tidal CO2 seems to be sufficient. So it's a very clear message. So if we had to recommend today how some patients undergoing major surgery, but non-obese patients, how they should be ventilated. Well, this is what is supported by the data that I showed you. This one here. This was supported by data that was published a long time ago. So you see here, no much need to think about. The tidal volume should be low. The PEEP is not really an issue. And, the RR is what we need to titrate to maintain the end-tidal CO2 between 35 and 45. If some hypoxemia develops, so what we can do is to combine levels of FiO2 that you can do the ventilator, do by yourself, combine it with some increases of the PEEP. And if it does not work, if the patient remains hypoxemic, then you can think of having an automatized maneuver as this kind of maneuver that I showed you with the stepwise change of the tidal volumes. In summary, the control of the mechanical ventilation can be really useful for most anesthesiologists, make the anesthesiologist free for other important tasks. We know that the end-tidal CO2 is related both to ventilation and perfusion, and we can try to use both to work with some automatized control systems, some closed-loop systems. Well, the combination of end-tidal CO2 with lung mechanics may provide a comprehensive control of the ventilator. But what we know for now at this time is that, what we need, lower tidal volumes, but not really the PEEP. This is not a major issue. Because the PEEP will not really have an influence on PPCs in most patients that are non-obese. So I believe that the easy control of the respiratory rate at a low tidal volume, targeting at the end-tidal CO2, accomplishes fully the needs that we have. Well, if necessary, in some patients, you can try to automatize this here, the FiO2 increase, and some recuperative maneuvers. Thank you for your attention.